Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. And for those that haven't paid £1 on Patreon for the exclusive access, this is the first episode of the year 2024. Unless I've absolutely balls up my episodes and it comes out beforehand. But it is planned. It'll be January 5th if you listen to this and you haven't paid money, which you should be. I am joined on this edition with another hot prospect in the world of Scottish professional wrestling and professional wrestling in general. I'm joined by Lee MacRae. Welcome to the show.
All right, Billy. Thanks for having me.
I'm glad to have you on. It's great to have, because I'm up in the Northeast. I see what's happening in the Central Belt, but I don't see it. You know what I mean? I see photos, I see the reviews, I see people being able to talk about it, but I don't actually see you guys wrestle live. I know you wrestle in Inverness, which we'll get into. So it's great to be able to speak to you and find out a little bit more about your story. So hopefully.
I say, where do you go and watch your wrestling shows on?
Mainly Aberdeen. Aberdeen. Yeah. Huh? So I'm in Elgin, so it's Aberdeen's the closest regular anyway that I can get to, unless they come up the Highlands every so often. But we'll hopefully find out a little bit more about Lee MacRae as we start the year off hot. That's the plan. Anyway, so basic question to start off with. Very, very low ball question when it comes to wrestling podcasts. How did you get into it? So what was the moment you watched wrestling or found out about wrestling that got you into it?
To be honest, everybody always has like a go-to answer, but I actually don't know. Yeah, I was never allowed to watch wrestling. I was never ever allowed to watch wrestling. You know, like it was kind of like people would bring action figures and that in school, you know, and I would kind of like re-watch it on YouTube and like really, really like it. But I was never allowed to watch it because it was too brutal and it was do this, that, and the next thing. But I can't remember how I got into it. It was just when you're young and you're a young lad in school, everyone liked wrestling. So I just kind of, people would like be playing the games and, you know, so there was no real moment where I was like, this is cool. I kind of pretended I liked it a lot for the start because everybody else liked it, you know?
That is a very, like, because I'm a bit old, I'm assuming I'm a bit older than you, but back in my day, it was just after the Attitude Era, so it was like it was one of those, like, dirty secrets if you liked wrestling, and I'm glad nowadays it seems to be just, I like what you like kind of thing, or people are allowed to express what they like, and it's not ridiculed for the most part.
The primary school in 2005. That was my first year of primary school. So then in like primary 3, 4 is when, so I would have been like 2008 time. That's when, like 2007, that's when everyone was like, oh, like watching wrestling. You know, but I actually can't really remember like watching it. I just remember everybody like talking about it, you know? Because my mom and dad wouldn't pay Sky because they're cheap, you know what I mean? So
So figures, and is there anyone you remember then, as figures go, or what the buzz was about? I'm assuming for that kind of year, what with John Cena, Randy Orton, that kind of.
It was. I remember my mate taking a Jeff Hardy action figure, and I remember thinking like, "Who's this guy?" sort of thing, you know, because like I remember he was really. So when I started watching wrestling later on, like 2010 time, that's kind of like. Jeff was on top. That was like that Armageddon, like 2009 bit. And I remember thinking, like, this guy is like off his nut because he had the tattoos, he had the dyed colored hair. Like, everything about it was stupid. Everything about him looked weird, but it worked. Mm-hmm. You know, like, he just didn't look like somebody off the street, you know? And I think it was that, like, over the topness that kind of, I was like, this is actually quite cool.
Oh man, that yeah. I mean, I've been a Jeff Hardy fan since over, but 10 years before then. So it was
he's actually off his head, but like it works. I like, I don't know. I think it was just the over the topness of the whole thing. Like, because you couldn't see him walking around Tesco's. You know what I mean? It's just, you know, it just doesn't work. And it was just like there was just that over the topness of it. I was like, oh, this is quite cool.
That's what makes it exciting, isn't it? It is that larger in lifeness. I mean, nowadays, I suppose some wrestling is a bit more real to life kind of thing, and you watch it and go, ah, but where's the silly bollocks? Where's the craziness? Where's the base paint and the mad facial hair and all that kind of stuff? And like you're saying, you wouldn't see this guy walking about picking up pasta from the aisles,
totally.
Going,
Like, you couldn't imagine, like, the Undertaker, like the Undertaker, like, paying council tax, could you? You know what I mean?
I know, and I think, just phoning up going, my name's Mark Calloway, Mr. M-A-R-K. No, it's Undertaker. Yeah. That's
he doesn't pay council tax. Well, he obviously...
There we go. That cameo money might be doing him well. He might have a second home here. That's
maybe.
So from that point onwards, then you started watching wrestling in 2010. So Jeff Hardy when he was,
he was the man then. Mm-hmm. He was, and he was so over. Do you know what I mean? Like, it was. Oh, I remember thinking like, this is really cool, but yeah, it was. I round about that time, that 2009 mark was when I would start watching it on YouTube. And it seemed a lot, and then I started watching like a lot of older wrestling, like when you were growing up and that, like you were saying, and like everybody was really like over the top.
Mm-hmm.
You know, not so much now. Like everyone now is kind of like a version of themselves, a wee bit. You know, like there's not many people that are just really out there who really just go for it. You know, I like that. I like that wrestling. You know, it's just like, yeah, it was entertaining, wasn't it?
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, that's why I like going to family-friendly shows, because that's the kind of thing you get. You do get the massive characters, because they're just there for the kids to go, oh my god, look at this clown. Like, literally a clown, not a clown. But yeah, that's what makes the wrestling so entertaining for me as a live experience, certainly. So from that point onwards then, you get into your 10. So that was like 2010. Makes it nice and easy for me to get round numbers going on then, because it's like I'm born 1990, so it makes my life easier when I'm doing sums. So from that point onwards, did you ever think, oh, that's something I want to do? Or was it a case of that was just your kind of relaxed thing you like to watch, and you did other things out with that, like other sports? What was your kind of relationship with possibly being a wrestler?
Well, I was always doing sports. Like, I was always either playing football. I did boxing. I did MMA. I did jiu-jitsu. And then I was kind of watching wrestling then, but then everybody sort of left wrestling for a wee while. You know, when you're in that weird stage where everyone's like, oh, wrestling's this and wrestling's that, wrestling's fake. It's stupid. It's not so much spoke about after that. So, and then I never really actually knew how to watch it. So I was just watching stuff on YouTube, you know, that was like prior to years back, or you'd be watching the same thing. Like, I wasn't keeping up to it with what's happening, because once again, my mum and dad wouldn't pay it.
Mm-hmm.
And then I think it was WrestleMania 30. So I was 14. And then I remember one guy talking about it in school who was like an absolute nerd who nobody ever spoke to. He was just like a complete nerd, nobody. Yeah? And I remember thinking, oh, he likes wrestling. Well, I like wrestling. I didn't want to like say it. And then he told me about an illegal streaming website that you could watch wrestling on, actually, that was all up to date. And I was like, oh, really? And he's like, yeah. So WrestleMania 30 was the first time I had ever watched like a pay-per-view from start to finish. And that just really sparked. And then after that, it was just watching Raw, I was watching SmackDown, I was just watching everything WWE related at that time, just all the time. Like at that time there was like the Shield, and then there was like, it was like Brock and Cena, and it was just like, I just fell in love with that. I wouldn't tell anybody that, but I fell in love with that.
So okay, right. So I mean, nerds can have their good points and bad points at times. I mean, he probably told you about that and then went on about something that you're like glaze over go with it. Just like, I don't know. I was basically Dungeons and Dragons, but I know that a lot of wrestlers like that. So we'll just move on from that. But you got back into it. Don't need to tell us what torrent it was. I do remember there was a few around about the time. I watched WrestleMania 30 on the network. I used one of the VPN things so I could sign up to the US one to watch it, because the network wasn't in the UK just yet. So we've all done it. It's tape trading. It's just modern day tape trading. That's what it was with the online sites. Of course, everyone now watches their wrestling legally. Of course, yeah, we've got the Peacock and whatever.
Yeah, there's so many places that you can watch it now.
Absolutely. It's insane. It really is, because even back in your day, back in my day, you'd have to hope to see something on TV because you couldn't tape it or get the VHS set up and all that kind of stuff. But yeah, even for yourself, YouTube or streaming or
yeah,
you fight.
then there was like Daily Motion as well. So I just kind of became obsessed with it. Like, obsessed with it. Like, I was watching it all the time. It was all I was thinking about. I mean, I was just sitting in school and stuff like that. And I just loved wrestling for some reason. Like, it's just like, it was just such a passion. I mean, it was just like, I would always think about it. I always wanted to talk about it. I just like, it wasn't like an element of it that I didn't like. The whole craziness, the whole stupid. I just loved wrestling. Huh?
Did you have like your were you a guy that had like buying the action figures and doing your own fed kind of thing? Did you do the online e-fedding or any of that kind of nonsense just to get that passion out there?
I didn't do any of that. I would just watch it, and occasionally I would try and maybe speak about it to somebody, but nobody else I know liked it. So I had nobody to talk to about. I would just sit by myself and just like watch it. Do you know what I mean? Like I didn't do any of that buying action figures and that. I would just sit for hours and just watch wrestling.
Just consuming it instead.
Yeah.
I suppose we've all gone through. I mean, I know that myself now. I mean, in where I live, there's really nobody. Like, I could actually physically speak to about wrestling. I go to shows and I do that, or go online instead. But it is weird that wrestling fans still have that kind of taboo about it because people have preconceptions about it as well. And we'll get into you actually doing it. But when people actually see it live and watch it and see how it's done and all that, it's not what the preconception is. You know, it's a very physically demanding and form of entertainment that people I don't think appreciate until they actually go to see it, which is why I always push the live experience. Even if you don't like watching it on telly, go see the live experience. That's what you need to see to fully embrace it and, like you say, consume it as well to want to see more. Who are your favorites then? Was there anyone when you were all that consuming? Was there anyone that you made to make sure to pick out to watch during that time?
So it was Hardy, and then Hardy left, and then after that it was Punk. It was CM Punk. Like, right, so see, like, wrestling now, this is one of my big problems I have, right? Everybody are like too nicey nice with each other, right? Like, they're in these rivalries, but back then in like the Attitude Era, people were just going for it, right? And Punk was like bringing like that mindset into it, right? Where you were really like, is this real? Like, is this getting out of hand? Like, you really didn't know, because he would be shooting, he would just be going against the man. Like, it was so like, he was just saying it straight. Do you know what I mean? He was just, I don't know, like, it was like when it feels like real like that, that you really don't know if this is a worker or not. That I think that's, you're so invested in it. He's going against Triple H. He's going against John Laurinaitis. He's going against Vince. Like, it was so, it was just, I loved CM Punk during that time. He was like, oh, I don't know. It was, I'll still go back now and watch that time period now. You know what I mean? It was really just like, you know, like sticking it to the man sort of thing, and just really just didn't care. He just spoke his mind, you know, like, yeah, I think he was great. Especially in that moment after Fight Bomb and that, you know?
Yeah, I mean, for I suppose for a younger audience, like you're saying, Attitude Era, we had Austin McMahon sticking it to the man and doing all that, and then for a younger crowd like yourself, it was CM Punk, and I suppose even nowadays, weirdly, it's still CM Punk for those that are coming in now, because he had that run in AEW and he was the voice, still the voice of the voiceless, or that's what he was calling himself anyway, and yeah, that gray area, that crossing the line where you don't know, because everyone comes in and goes, right, okay, this is still physical, but you know, the storyline, it's entertainment at the end of the day, we'll watch that for that. But he, like you're saying, he just brought that little bit of an edge and blurring line. And I suppose nowadays it is a little bit more neutered. AEW do it a lot, maybe to the point of oversaturation of doing that, where everything is marketed towards online watchers and viewers. I suppose WWE don't do it as much, except a wink wink here and there. But that's the stuff you get invested in when it feels real.
Yeah.
that's what wrestling's supposed to be. It's supposed to feel real at the end of the day.
Yeah. Like when people hear you talk about like, oh, putting each other over. Mm-hmm. When you look at Austin and The Rock, nobody was putting each other over.
Mm-hmm.
They were going at it with each other. Do you know what I mean? And I just loved that time. Like, I remember it was Punk, obviously, in Money in the Bank 2011. And I remember like watching his entrance and that, and the place going mental for him. You know, and then like the match, the whole story behind it. And then after that, there was him and Triple H at Night of Champions. And of course, when he had brought in Kevin Nash and that, and it was so like, it was real. It felt so real, do you know? And I love that. I love that type of wrestling. You know, that you really think, where's this going to go? Like, are they going to go out here? Do you know what I mean? And he's like, oh, this is not CM Punk talking a trip with Phil Brooks talking at Paul Levesque. It's just like those little digs. It's like, you know?
Mm-hmm. That's it. It's the emotional side of things. And I suppose people, I mean, even myself, talk about things like, it's wrestling now is about moments, maybe less than matches. And that's kind of how you're describing wrestling for me anyway. It's you haven't really described any of the matches, but you described the moments that pulled you in, the emotive bits, the promos, you know.
There's so much build up to it. There's not a lot of promos now. Like when you watch AEW and stuff like that, you know, there's not a lot of promo. Like if you watch WWE a lot, there's a lot of promos happening, backstage segments, people kind of make them. There's not so much of that anymore. You know, a lot of people are afraid to talk. Maybe
people forget that for a TV product anyway, someone's going to watch for the first time. I think that's what WWE does. It doesn't try to insult you. It sometimes does insult the audience, but they need to make sure that if you're a first-time viewer, you're watching WWE for the first time, you're kind of caught up before you get to the first match, kind of thing. Caught up with what's the gen of the show. And this isn't going to be an AEW versus WWE podcast, because we need to speak about yourself, Lee MacRae. But AEW kind of has that opposite thing where they trust that you're coming in because you've seen it's the alternative and you know what's happening already, and you watch it and they're doing little insider jokes, and that's what's put me off that promotion the majority of the time. Is when I watch it, I go, I have no idea what's happening. Nobody's explained this to me. And they're going, oh, this person's coming in. Why is he a big deal? You know, that's I need that little bit of context, because so much wrestling now, I need the context with it at the same time.
It's impossible as well to keep up with everything that's going on.
Mm-hmm.
Because how many hours are there a week of wrestling just everywhere? You know, like
after the TNA tour or the Impact Wrestling tour, I was trying to keep up with TNA, and it's again nigh on impossible when I'm trying to fit in a real life, and I do the stuff with the website as well. It's just absolutely impossible. Let's get back to you though. So from that point onwards, you're watching wrestling, and who did you figure out, right, okay, this is what I want to do now? You say that you've done things like jiu-jitsu. Was that kind of your way of kind of doing the wrestling but not doing the wrestling at the same time?
I always enjoyed like just that apex sort of, like, you know, like that, like
the physicality, like, kind of thing.
I was always into that. You know, I was always into, like Conor McGregor and that. Like, I'd always like that. And you couldn't do wrestling here. There's nowhere. There's no training school. I mean, so I started MMA when I was 17, and then when I was, because I'm still living at home and all that at that time, so I couldn't afford to go to Glasgow or go to Aberdeen. You know, twice a week. You know, so MMA was my fix of kind of the same as, you know, but yeah.
I mean, it at least gives you also, if there is ever the moment you got to go do training, you at least have kind of a foundation level of yourself.
Like MMA was my passion as well, but wrestling was always what I wanted to do. Yeah.
So from that point, when were you able to finally, or when did you finally just go, right, I need to go down to Glasgow, I need to do this?
It was probably WrestleMania 30, 2014 was when I was like, I want to be a wrestler. And like, this is going to sound like really bad, but I always thought I'd be good at it.
Right.
You know, I'm not one of these ones that was like, oh man, I didn't really have the confidence to do it, and this, that, and the next thing. I always thought I could do it and I could be good at it, because I kind of piss people off anyway in my day to day life. You know, like I feel like I'm just like a natural heel walking around anyway. You know, and wrestling is just bigger than that. And then I think it was 2019, November 2019. I wasn't really doing anything. I was just working like all these odd jobs, and I was like doing like the like MMA and that. But by that time, I'd been doing it for quite a while, and I had a couple of competitions. And then I was just like, oh, "This is the I'm just gonna if I'm 19 now." And I kept putting off. So when I in November 2019, that's when I signed up for the GPWA intake. We done like I think 3-4 weeks of just rolls, and then COVID hit, and then everything shut. So. Right. I never took a bump. I didn't do a tie-up. I didn't do anything in that time period. So I don't really count that as anything. So we're just doing a forward roll. And obviously, I can do a forward roll. Do you know what I mean? So, and then it was August of 2021 is when they reopened again. September 2021, when they reopened again, that was when I came back to wrestling. And then I had to do all that intake all over again. So realistically, I didn't start learning how to tie-up or follow that until maybe like December of 2021.
So would you say you feel like a natural heel? Is it just because is there a bit overconfidence or
I think so. Yeah,
be confidence.
Yeah, I think people get the wrong way. You know, like I would kind of like I don't know. I would watch it. I would tell my mom and my dad like I'm gonna do that. I'm gonna be good at it. I know I can be good at it. You know, it's just I'm not just a brat really. You know what I mean? I'm just and they're kind of like no, okay, you know. So I don't know. I just always thought I would just be good at it for some reason. I always thought I could do it and do it well. I don't know. Maybe it's my own fault. But...
Well, I mean, at the end of it, we're recording November 2023, but it's you're doing it. So you must have been able to at least do it competently before you're on shows, at the very least.
I'm really into pissing people off.
Mm-hmm.
Which is like stupid and immature, but I just really am. Like, if, I don't know.
I don't know if it's maybe because you've got that background in martial arts. We'll get into the wrestling, but maybe just because you've got a background in martial arts, you know that you can be a bit confrontational, but you know you've got the background before it. So if someone does try to square up to you, like you said, it probably is a bit immature, probably is a bit twash, but you know that you can at least hold your own if someone comes back at you. You know you can at least neutralize them for a moment to calm things down.
It's not even that. It was just having that like confidence in myself that I could do anything I wanted and do it well. Which is weird because nobody around me is like that. So,
it's the parents always said counsel that wrestling's wrong for melting people's brains and all that kind of stuff. Maybe wrestling's to blame. So you go down to GPWA properly after you've done your months of rolling, and there's a pandemic where you've probably just sat there going, I've just started my wrestling journey and I've just been told to stop it now. And
I was just, that was a nightmare.
I suppose if you're up in the... Where you're still up in the Highlands at this point, nothing nearby, kind of thing. It's not like you can just.
There's nothing you can do. There's only so much you can do by yourself, right? Also, you need to have somebody who's going to do it with you and knows how to do it. And even that, there's only so much you can do. You need a ring as well. Like we're just not equipped for anything up here.
Anywhere you wanted to go was hours away for a one-to-one and, you know, masks and don't leave at home. And oh, it's just, I suppose for myself, it didn't really matter. I was in my house, but this is what I do now. I do podcasting. So it wasn't a big deal that way. But at least for yourself that's champing at the bit, that has all that piss of vinegar just to go, right, I want to do this because I'm going to do it and I'm going to do it well. And you've just been told, nah, you can't for now. So you're back then August, September 2021. You get back into it. You're able to wrestle again. And you must have just like blasted through, because I think we've got your debut around about what, the year after-ish kind of thing. So
I don't know. This is going to sound bad, but I kind of took to it like a duck in water. I just kind of, because like I knew the crack going into it. Like I'd watched it for so long that I kind of, and I'm, because I'm naturally athletic anyway, and I was always been, I could always, like you know, I could, I was always playing football, I was always doing boxing, like I was always like in shape, you know. So I was never having to, like, people were coming in who were just fans of it, watched it once, and they couldn't run the ropes and stuff like that, you know. Like, I was, what blew my mind when I actually showed up there was the amount of people that showed up who just were not, who, like, in my mind had, like, do you have any idea what this even is? It, like, people who just, like, watched it one time, thought, oh, I could do that, and just got off their couch and came, and then did it once or twice and never ever came back again, you know.
Okay, I get that. Right, this is a wee rant on my end, but it's when you see people getting their photo taken at shows, when they go in the ring and get a photo taken with one of the wrestlers, you know, the amount of people I've seen who cannot get into a ring. How much wrestling have you watched to not know how to step into a ring, like, at least step over the middle rope?
It's not even that. It's not exactly hard. It's not something that somebody has to teach you how to do. You know? But some people just couldn't do it, you know. But it was like they were just, like, really unprepared for it. There were just, like, people who just, like, got off the couch one day thinking this was just going to be one big walk in the park that way. You know, but I always trained for it because I knew it was going to be hard, you know. So I took to it, like, because I had prepared myself for it. I kind of took to it quite well. Yeah, and because I lived so far away, like, I was having to travel from Glasgow to Inverness 3 times a week, every week. And I did, and what blew my mind was people who lived 10 minutes away from that school, and you wouldn't see them for weeks on end. You know, and because I think I lived so far away, I was just doing that little bit extra than everybody else was. I just had more of, like, a drive in me, you know, because there's people who, it was right on their doorstep, so they just took it for granted. And, like, I was training all the time, like they would have, like, open time, you know. Like, I would have work the next day at 6 o'clock in the morning, and I wasn't getting in from Glasgow till 3 a.m. because I just wanted to just do it and 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 just rep it out. And just, I loved it though, you know. I just loved wrestling, like, and then when I was doing it as well, like, I was just like, it was just like, I don't know, I just felt like it gave me such, like, a feeling that I never, like, I just don't know. I feel like I'm put here to wrestle. I think that's what I'm here to do, you know.
So, I was gonna say competitiveness. I mean, there is that in that aspect, and absolutely, but I suppose, when, like you're saying, if you're traveling, if you're willing to travel 3 hours, 6 hours there and back to go and do this, and you're seeing people come in and just flaunting it, fanning about for an hour, and then going home, walk up the road where you've still got to do all that travel. It's almost like, in some respect, you are paying your dues early because you're putting in the effort, you're putting in the work, you're putting in the time and energy to do it. And you have to do it at that point. If you're paying for 3 times a week or so to go down to Glasgow, and it comes of nothing, and you're not making any progress, and then you've wasted money, time, energy. You have to have an end game. And, like you're saying, that seems to be your mindset, is always, my end goal is I'm going to be a wrestler because I've put too much work into it, and I need to do it. I love to do it. This is what I want to do at the same time. So,
like, I was paying, like, £150, £200 out of my own pocket every week just to get me there and back, because then, like, I'd have to go there and back, work in between that. And then if I had, like, a show on, like, a Friday or a Saturday, I wasn't getting my expenses paid for, you know. And it was the only way around it was just to do it, you know. And it's weird, though, because, like, sometimes, like, I get a little bit, like, oh, this is a lot of money I'm forking out for this. Like, a lot of money that could probably go elsewhere because I live so far away. But then it's also like, I just can't stop. Like, this is like, it's, and I will never stop wrestling until physically I can't do it anymore, because I've got such, like, a passion and, like, a desire in me that I just can't let it go. Like, before this call chat with you, like, I was just sitting there watching this week's wrestling. Like, I just, it consumes all my life, and you know what I mean? And it's like, maybe I'm addicted. I just can't stop. You know, I just can't stop.
That was the exact word I had in my head when we were just having that little bit there. Addiction. It's an addiction to wrestling, and there's worse things you can be addicted to. You know?
Yeah, You know, and it's just like there's nothing else. Because I'm not really like a sociable person. I don't really mix well with others. I don't know. I'm quite a strange person anyway. Wrestling's the only place that, and like I don't care about a lot of things as well. You know, like obviously like I work and stuff like that. But like I don't know. I'm just very much like I just I don't know. Maybe I'm a little bit like ADD or that. But I can't seem to focus on things. And unless I care about it. So I don't care about anything really. The one thing that absolutely has me is wrestling. You know, little things like if I've got a match next day and I'm packing my gear bag, that brings me such joy. I don't know why. It's just, and when I'm having a match and stuff like that, like that's the only thing that actually genuinely I look forward to. There's nothing at all that really gets me like that, you know. And if I didn't do this, I don't know what I'd be doing. Put it that way, you know.
That's a really, it's, yeah, it's a fantastic lookout on it, because like we're getting to it is all or nothing for you at this stage, especially at your age as well, where you've got a long career ahead of you as well, and you're that passionate at this stage. It's probably one of those things where if you don't have that joy packing a bag, then possibly that's when your passion may waver. But as long as you've got that kind of passion for it, let's just skip straight ahead then to your debut. Like, I've got it down. I'm assuming there's probably going to be like 5-pound wrestling and showcase shows beforehand. So I've got it written down here as your first one being Inverness for a GPWA showcase match against Drew Mercury. Am I right? Is that about the right main show?
No. Yeah, but the first that fight, that was in the Asylum, though. That was in Glasgow, my first 5-pound match with him.
Right.
I faced Drew in the WXS in Inverness like a month later. But my first one.
Okay, right. So yeah, the 5-pound shows, I don't get the results from them because they're friends and family. So I'm neither a friend nor a family, it seems.
When was that? Was that August or September?
I've got October, 2022, Inverness.
No, so then it was September was when I debuted.
Right.
September 20.
What was it like then? So Drew, of course, he's up in the Highlands as well. So a little bit of a coming of two guys that have done the travel, done the work, and now you're getting to actually do a match. So how was your feelings going into that?
I just felt like I can do this. So, like I wasn't like there was a few boys who made their debuts that night and they were like, you know, I just felt like I was calm all day. I was just chilled out. I knew I could go out there and get a reaction because there's people that hadn't seen wrestling and I know they'd react to me. It was genuinely fine. Do you know what I mean? Like I wanted that moment a lot sooner than that. You know, it was good. Yeah, we put on a good match. We put on a good reaction. Jester is our coach, and he put me and Drew on first because he says I know you two will get them going. It was fine. Basic style match. So really basic structured, but it was our first time. You know, I was wanting to do all this.
But I suppose nice and easy end. So I mean, we've already established in our 40 minutes ish that we spoke that you were confident. So there's no butterflies. You felt like you're born to do this. So this is just the first stage, the first chapter of the next chapter, kind of thing. It was your
like
journey properly beginning.
Age, and then my music hit because I remember Jester comes up, he says, "Right, you're on, you need to come now." So I remember just being backstage waiting for them, and in the backstage they've got a monitor of like the hard cam, so you can see everybody there, you know. And it was just like, and then my music started hitting, and it was like something just came over me where it was like I just went straight out there, and I just don't know, it's like you're not you when you're out there, if you know what I mean. Something else comes. It's like this. It's just feeling that it's like such a high that it's like you cannot describe. Of everybody just, it's weird though, because like when I play football and that, like you're one in so many, you know, but then when you're wrestling, it's only you, everyone's watching you, you know. And I always kind of suppose I always wanted to be like the center of attention a little bit, as it was anyway. So I don't know. When I got back, I remember thinking I want to go back out there and do all that again. You know what I mean? And the fact that people were looking at me and booing me, because I'm really into pissing people off anyway, and I was doing it, I was getting paid for it.
And like, they can't do anything about it. There's a big barrier there. So,
you know. Oh, do you know what I mean? Like, it just genuinely is mental. Like, it's the whole thing just is just, I don't know. I love the whole thing, though.
So the first match I've got in is the Inverness one. So that's a month in. You've had your first match, you've debuted, and now you're getting to go, for all intents and purposes, you're getting to go home to wrestle in a venue that doesn't exist anymore, as well, being the Ironworks. So growing up, was the Ironworks a venue that you frequented? Was that a place that you thought, right, one day I'm going to be in here as well? Was that just, a mind-blowing experience?
Did you ever go to that show? So genuinely, Elgin.
No, weirdly enough, and this is going to sound absolutely terrible, but that same night, we got tickets for Alan Carr, and it rescheduled that night. So I went to go see that because I'd already booked my tickets, and I was sitting there going, waiting.
Alan Carr, then go see WXS.
I didn't say rather. I said I had tickets booked, and I think, well, I favored the wrath of my wife over going to see wrestling that night, and I thought, no, I will just go to the show that I've already got tickets for, even though I was sitting waiting for results, just waiting for it. Just going, what's happening at the same time.
I expected more from you, to be honest. That just sounds like excuses to me.
You have a higher opinion of myself than I do, so that's so that show
I faced to do it again. That was good. That was my mum and my sister and all that, they came and watched me for the first time. Which they're not a fan of wrestling at all. They just don't like it. They just don't see the point in it. I think my mum's more scared I'm going to get hurt. Nobody else likes it. My dad doesn't like it. But they came to watch me anyway, because it's like 2 minutes away from their house. And they came, watched me, and then just took off again. They just don't like it, you know? And it's like, it's kind of, I don't really have that support system at all as such, because nobody gets it, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, they'll say to me, are you still doing all that, like, nonsense? And I'm like, yeah, really, right. Like, when you're going to get a real job, you know?
that's, I mean, you think that if they got to see it, and like, this is not a therapy podcast, but you think if they got to see you and see the passion you have for it, that maybe would be going, okay, I don't like it, but I get it. You know, that kind of thing, and be able to nurture that. But I suppose that you go down the road that often, you've built a support network elsewhere that you're able to share stories and share your enthusiasm for the sport.
Because like, I was like to my mum, I was like, oh, so what did you think? She was like, yeah, it was all right. She just can't take that at all. Right? She just doesn't get it.
I suppose watching your son, I mean, obviously, you battered Drew, and you had no problems. But watching your son possibly get injured, that is, I don't know, there is probably a always going to be a doubt there, a fear that she's going to get a call at 3 a.m. going, oh, Lee's in the hospital because he's broken something, kind of thing. There's probably always going to be that in the back of their mind.
Because she shit herself, because Drew hit me with a DDT and I spiked myself on it. Which was actually, I didn't mean to, and then she was, you know, I think she thought like I was dead, you know what I mean? And of course, Drew's family popped for it.
I know, on two sides of the same coin, his family just going, yeah, kill him. And she's like, oh, dinner.
It's weird though. I remember I scoped his family out beforehand. I was like, oh, who's all coming tonight from your family? And he's like, oh, yeah. And yeah, he went to go and see them prior to that. And I remember scoping them out beforehand. And I made sure when I did my entrance, I went around that way. And I was just giving them what for that whole entire match. Good fun, man.
But that DDT was the most cathartic experience for them after.
That was.
I mean, I'll pick and choose because we've had an absolute crack chat already. So I'm going to pick and choose match because we've got loads of questions to get through as well from the Instagram and whatnot.
I've actually got a bone to pick with you quickly. Yeah.
Oh, right. Okay.
So you first time you watched me was in Peterhead.
Yes.
Right. First time you see me. Now, I then watched your review on that afterwards. Right.
Right.
If you don't remember it or not, you do your online, your website one, and then you also did your video one where you were talking like this and talking about it.
Yeah.
Right? Now, I know, apart from maybe like two guys, I was probably the best on that show.
Right.
Right? And I watched your review, and you were giving everybody this amount of compliments. You were giving everybody that. You were like, oh, this person, that person, and fought it. Came up my match versus Martin McAllister, and you're like, oh, really buzzing to see Martin. You know, I've never seen him for the first time. Lee, yeah, he was good. Very entertained. Right, next.
Oh, I did a... Oh, what a dick.
That was it.
Oh, I feel really bad, because I was about to really...
The only thing you mentioned our match was the fact Martin McAllister had light up shoes. Like, who actually cares? Dude, oh, Martin McAllister, oh, no, times. You come up with light up shoes, Lee. Oh, yeah, great guy. I've seen him for the first time yet, next. And then after that, we had so-and-so. I was like,
I feel really bad, because the next match I've got is about Peterhead, but I do have it written down, and I was about to say that I really enjoyed it. Unfortunately, I didn't seem to forget at the time. it's okay. I've never had on the spot feedback before. I don't know how to.
That blew my mind right then and there, and I was waiting to do one of these so I could tell you that. Because I know I did good that night, like really good that night. And I was like, is that it?
You know, that's really irritating. That's really irritated me, because I'm absolutely sure that I did. I thought I did anyway, that I blew smoke up your ass for that match, because it was the first time seeing you. At this point, I'd only seen your name a couple times, spelled in different ways.
I was meant to face Davey that night. And you seemed to pop more that it was for Martin, the fact that I beat Martin. Yeah, oh, what a nice surprise that was.
Oh, okay, right. I don't know where to go now. But okay, we're just going to skip ahead to that one. Because we've got other things like ICW debut with Landrail, which we'll get to Shug's house party, because that's quite a big milestone to hit so early on. But yes, from what I remember, and I'll tell you face-to-face over Zoom so you don't batter me. But yeah, I was pleasantly surprised, because you were so early in and you were so polished, and the gear looked great. You looked great, and Martin is such a sympathetic soul that you're able to very easily just have a really great match. And yes, I will.
Are you just saying that to me now because you're talking to me over FaceTime, or do you?
No, not at all. No, really, generally not. I apologize. I didn't put it in the episode itself, but I had a really great night for first time seeing CPW as well. Every match kind of just tickled me right. It did the job. Anyway, we'll move on. Right. So we'll talk ICW then, because of course when you go into GPWA, there's always going to be a trajectory, an opportunity. And we do things like WXS, Blockbuster now, and of course ICW. And you kind of hit the ground running with ICW when I've got your first match going here with Krieger. As a guy that, you know, yourself, tall guy, built guy, and you're coming in against a guy like Krieger, who's also tall, a bit more experienced, can pack a punch. That's quite a big... Yeah, especially when you're going against guys like Drew before, who's smaller, high flying. You can a guy kind of match you with power. What's it like getting into an ICW ring and be able to face someone with the reputation like Krieger?
Because I'm 6'3", so I'm not the smallest guy there. There's a lot of smaller wrestlers now, you know, and like a lot of my moveset were based around slamming somebody. Krieger was the first time that I had actually met somebody who was taller than I was, who was bigger than I was, and just physically, just like, you know, like he's you met Krieger?
I have, yeah. Very tall. Very tall.
He's very intimidating, actually, because he's just a large guy. Like, he just takes up such a surface area. Just a hard guy as well, you know, and he's been doing it a long time. Yeah, I'm actually facing Krieger tomorrow in Blockbuster.
Of course you do. Yeah, unfortunately, this is going to be 2 months away. But yes, you are facing Krieger. So that's a nice kind of, I don't know, not really a full circle, because it was middle of the year that you spoke. But that kind of, you get to see where you've went last 6 months or so, 5 months, being able to face him then to now. Is that something that you're excited to see how you progress that time?
Because now I know how he works, I know how he does, and I'll come back in and I'll beat him tomorrow. I will beat him tomorrow. I think that's just because having that experience. I mean, it was the first time I had met somebody that big, and just like his presence, like, see, when you look at him on the debut, just looking at him across the ring, he's just staring at me, you know. And I was the first time I was like, oh. And I had talked. Did you ever see my promo in the build up to that match?
Positive, I did. It was a while ago, but I'm positive because you talked with quite a lot of confidence.
I talked a lot. I smacked it, like, and then the build up to that match. He fired back, like, and I remember thought, he's gonna destroy me here.
Was that the first time for you that possibly you thought for a moment that you may have bit off more than you can chew with your words, thinking, okay, maybe he could actually batter me.
I think I underestimated him, because I did a promo to him to let people know I was coming in, and I went in on him. You should actually just go back and watch it. And then he came back at me like bigger though, and then it was the first time that I'd seen him, and I was like, oh my god, don't hurt me, you know. He's a massive guy, and he's, but then afterwards, just a nice guy. Yeah, mm-hmm. It's a nice guy, but when you're in there, it's very
quite intimidating for a moment. Yeah.
Remember I slapped him in the back of the head. I was trying, and then I remember he just turned around and just looked at me. It was like when Taker grabs a hold of you and throws you in that corner, and it's just like, you know, like, genuinely, I can still see his face now.
Oh, that's incredible.
Right, and he bet me that night that he powerbombed me, that pop-up powerbomb, and that legitimately was the worst thing I've ever taken in wrestling. My soul left my body when I hit that mat, because I came down at such force in the sit, and I went, I was done. I physically done. I couldn't have done a second more. Like, that pin was the most legit pin that's ever happened, because I genuinely couldn't have kicked out of that.
Is it just one of those, is that the first moment, like, so we talked about, like, fear, a tiny bit of fear, but is that the first time you were humbled, moment going, right, okay,
yeah,
when I'm facing someone, I possibly need to do a little bit more on research than just making sure that I'm ready for it.
I've got a game plan for tomorrow. I know what he does. I know what he does, man. I'll beat Krieger tomorrow. See, when this comes out, you know, I'll beat him, Krieger. You heard it here first, right?
That's right. I'll be waiting for Wesley to give me the gen of the show, and I'll make sure that I will see Lee MacRae defeated Krieger. And if I don't, then I don't know what I'm going to do. But in the meantime, so from that point onwards, then you got Shug, we've got CPW, Community Pro as well. We kind of talked about it, which I was going to speak about probably later on, but we've already had the CPW discourse where I've been rinsed for my comments.
I was the one who was rinsed. I mean,
I didn't mention you to rinse you, so it's fine.
Beat him, do you know what I mean? I hit that like suicide dive to the floor. I mean, the reaction I got, and you're going on about his light up boots.
Well, next time CPW come to Peterhead, I'll make sure I'll do a big paragraph.
Wears light up shoes to school.
maybe we just need light up shoes next time, and I'll be well invested in it. But no, genuinely, I'm not saying this just so we can continue. But yeah, you were hell of impressive, especially for someone that far in, because when I see new guys, I've been around here a long time, even though I only ever end up going to shows in my local area, but it's I've seen shite, to be honest. I've seen shite first time people, and I watched it going, why are they talking about this guy on net? I don't get it, I don't understand. And I've seen good, and you were definitely in that category where I go, right, okay, I can see something here. Especially when you got guys like Ryan Richards as well from up here, and you got Mayhem Brooks going, okay, that up north, there's some good stuff coming through.
Yeah, I know.
So of course you do, because you're one of them. so the pre-show of Shugs, that's quite a big deal. You've had a couple matches at ICW, and then you're against Landon Riley. Didn't come out victorious on that night, but still having been on that card being on a show that would be eventually, I think it was streamed on Fight that night. I don't know if the pre-show was done, like their countdown, I can't remember. But still, being in front of a crowd like that, a full full-size ICW crowd, again, was there, had your nerves with Krieger, but does the size of a crowd affect you at all?
Not really. The more the better. Did you watch that match?
I haven't seen it, no.
You're gonna have to go watch it, huh? that was a good match. That was a really good match. That was the first time in my life. Okay, this is gonna sound a bit cringy. That's the first time ever in my life when I came backstage and I actually felt proud of myself or something. We were the first one out, so the first person they seen that night was me, and everyone was hammered. They were all loud, and they reacted, and everything was just. That was a brilliant night. That was a fantastic night, you know. And I didn't even like looking back at it now because I've watched it so many times. I can't actually see it through my eyes. I can only ever see it through a screen of when I'm watching me and him, but I can't actually see it myself, you know.
Yeah.
Like almost as if it didn't happen in a weird way.
Is that the moment that you felt like that you'd made it? Like all that travel, you've wrestled for a while beforehand, but is that the moment where you really went, right, okay, this is my occupation now?
No, not really, because I never have that feeling. There's so many boys that are content with that. Like, that's a big, like content with that. Like, they think they made it. Like, no. To me, like, that was really cool. That's done now. I'm not going to sit and dwell on it and go, oh, and I, like, pee myself over it. Like, okay, what's the next thing?
Okay.
You know, just keep topping it. Just keep topping it, you know? It was really good. I was really happy to be on it. I was really glad I got picked, actually. I didn't think, because there was a lot of guys who they could have chosen that was a lot better than me. Then, not now, but... Yeah, but then when Scott and Jester told me, "Oh, we're going to put you on the show at the Shug's house party," you know, I mean, like, I was like, "Oh, that was a big deal to me." Yeah, like, that was the first time that, like, I'd love to do that night all over again. Just the emotion mixed through it as well. Like, obviously, that was like a roller coaster. That was unlike anything I'd ever felt before. You know what I mean? And the crowd were just really giving me every bit of energy that they had, and it was a brilliant night. It was a brilliant night. Like, even though I didn't beat London that night, but all in all, just the experience of just coming out to that many people with like the actual like the set, and there's people all the way up the top, you know, and it's just like, it was just, I don't know, it was weird. Like, it just felt like, I was like, how's this not happened sooner?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's like you've had that vision since you started training, going, right, this is what's going to happen. I'm going to come out, there's going to be folk hanging from the rafters. This is what's going to happen. And then that, in that moment, I was like, right, now I've got a new thing I need to do. I've done this next thing. It's going to be more people. It's going to be titles. It's going to be all that kind of stuff.
Like, because we were on the pre-show as well, and there was a lot of people there. And that was on the pre-show. There was so many people there. And, like, I thought maybe because they'd only seen me once on ICW, nobody might not know who I am. But when I came out, they reacted to me. Like, they booed me out of that place when I got made that reaction. I was not expecting that. I was expecting maybe I'm going to come out and they're not going to know who I am. Mm-hmm. They did know who I am. So, like, I think the ICW fans, like, they keep up with what's going on, you know, as well. Mm-hmm. They know. Go watch that match.
I will endeavor to do. I think I need to now, just for to make up for you, and maybe even write
you
about
fight.
It.
You have fight. Yeah,
fight. No, I don't have fight. So I occasionally watch Fight Club when I can, when I do a month subscription or whatever. But I don't keep it running regularly because unfortunately I have grown up responsibilities, and it's a disgusting thing to have right now. But I will get to it. I will get to it. I promise you. By the time this episode goes out, I will have watched it.
Okay,
I'll say that, and you can test me on it after the episode comes out. I've set myself up there for a fail. Anyway, right. So I'm just curious. When you said it sounds like you're very competitive, you know what you want to do. I was just curious, around about this time, ish, or around about a couple months ago anyway, GPWA, of course, merged with Source as well, and then they brought in more people to train with. Was that something that was an exciting prospect for you? You got new people to throw about, or to learn from, or to work with? Was that something that when you heard or knew it was happening, was like, right, okay, I know I'm ready for this, and I'm still going to be top of the class anyway, but at least I've got new people to work with?
So, yes and no. Yes, as in you got new bodies, new people to do. You get comfortable with the people you work with. You know who you can batter, and you know who puts up a good fight. You know them, and you've seen them every week. With Source coming in, it was new bodies, new faces, new people, new different movesets, new people way to do things. Yeah, for that aspect. And also, I was excited for that. But also knew that you've got a load of guys in there who are trying to get your spot as well. Yeah, so it brings out competition's good. You know, I think it keeps you at the top of your game, because there's all these guys who are coming in now who are now being part of 5 Pound, who have never been, because it was GPWA's thing, but now they're part of it because they're part of the school. So many guys are wanting on that show, but so many guys are wanting your spot, but they're not going to get it. So,
especially moving into next year when it seems like, well, Fight Club, by the time this comes out, Fight Club will be finished. The last taping's December 17th.
What are you doing next Saturday? What are you doing next Saturday?
Next Saturday, I will be at WrestleZone, Christmas Chaos, in Aberdeen.
Okay. £5 wrestling on that day, last one of the year.
I may have to take it with it next year. We'll see how next year goes. This year. This episode comes out in 2024. I don't want to just spoil the illusion. Keep that in mind, though. So there's possibly less spots next year, because if ICW or Getaway Fight Club, and they're only doing like monthly events, specials kind of thing, then you're all working towards the same spot. It's going to be very interesting to see who has that kind of drive to go through. Like yourself, sounds like you've got that drive. It's just more a case of who's gonna try and stop you. Really, that's the next thing.
Yeah, because as much as like you're working with them, you're all working against them as well, because there can only be like, there's so many spots in that show. There's so many people who can do it. There's so many people who are good wrestlers, but they can only pick so many guys, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's just more like, why should they pick you over somebody else? And there's so many people that are coming in here. I haven't been on ICW since September, you know, in November. So I'm hoping with this new rebranch, with the new like relaunch that they're doing, that I'll have, because I was just having matches, you know, and I was wanting to have a reason to be there, be a part of a storyline, be a part of something that I can really try. And like, when you're just having like matches here and there, you can't really like showcase all that you can do, you know? So trying to find a reason to be there, you know, that's my next thing. I'm just keep pitching stuff to Scott and Jester and that, you know. So, but then again,
2024, we could be speaking, and this is going to be your breakout year. You could be the one to watch, or whatever. This could be
your... kind of the breakout star this year, because I kind of made my debut and I kind of was on Shug's, you know, straight away. And you know, now people kind of know who I am a little bit more now in that wrestling scene, when they didn't 6 months ago. So next year, you know, you heard it here, and you know,
2024, the year of Lee MacRae. Right, let's dive into the questions, because they're all a bit weird, but we'll get through them. We've got James Erdis, if I apologize if I've said that wrong, sir, on Twitter, X, whatever it's called. He has put, and I'll just read it verbatim, please let Mr. MacRae know that I've studied so-called trash talk since our altercation at Gut Check. I haven't spoken about Gut Check. I now know, after being called a virgin, a traditional response would have been to suggest I had entangled myself with his promiscuous mother.
Right. What's his name? James, is it? What's his name?
James Erdis. Erdos?
Well, we all had to do, I'll brief it down. We all had to go in there and do like 30 seconds of chain wrestling and then run an international spot. Right, and it just so happened we were in a queue, and I came after him. So I went in there and I remember looking across the ring and thinking, what the fuck? It's just by the way he was dressed, you know what I mean? And I actually said to him, you look like a virgin, mate. Like, I don't get what you were trying to do you know what I mean? And he wasn't too impressed with me at all, you know what I mean? But I don't know. That's actually a match that I want to do. You know what I mean? I'm calling James out just now. I'm calling James out just now, you know what I mean? Because he just gave it back to me just now, so let me batter that little boy.
I mean, you don't say anything about Mrs. MacRae without getting battered. That's...
It's not that. You just don't take a dig at me anyway, just without getting battered, you know what I mean?
We'll briefly speak about Gut Check then, because that's, again, first full year, and you've taken the chance on yourself. You've put yourself forward for the Impact Wrestling Gut Check, and there was a lot of people. There were a lot of people. When I was seeing the little video that they put out, I got to see. You did. I think you popped up in there at some point. That's a big network of Scottish wrestlers, and you're in there. You do a little bit. Did you get any feedback that day? Or was it just the experience that you went? Well, obviously you went to be picked, but it was the experience, the thing that you came with the way with that you're happy with, or just what was that like?
Well, it was more. See, like I knew going into it, I wasn't going to get picked because there was guys there who had been wrestling a lot longer than I had. You know, like I'm like fairly new. I'm not even doing this 3 years yet. You know, but there was guys there who had been there for a long time. So I knew experience level stuff like that. I kind of knew I wasn't going to get it. But it was more to see what they're looking for, right? Okay, because it's one thing to be all right. Like shows in Scotland, you know, like a wee Friday night, just family friendly. And then it's another thing to be on TV in front of millions and millions of people. It's two different things, you know. So it was more just to like, and there's a few guys who have had the experience of being away, you know, and they can tell you certain things, but like a lot of the boys just now are away. So I'm kind of surrounded by a lot of people who are kind of just doing sort of the same-ish thing that I'm doing. So it was just really good to just go and see Scott and Gail and Joe and just be like, what was good? What was bad? How can I prove? How can I get a spot on your show? Mm-hmm. You know, sort of thing.
So a good, the experience was great, but the networking was the bonus.
You know, and obviously like they had a few compliments of what I should keep doing. And then they're just things that maybe try and do this differently, you know? Because like you say, it's one thing in a family friendly show, there's one thing on a TV, you know, there's so many guys who went in there and had matches and started doing that to the crowd, you know, mm-hmm. like it doesn't work and impact, you know, so it's just been able to, how can I get to that level, you know?
Yeah. As long as Scott Damore didn't say that you need light up shoes, I'm sure it was all great. Right. I'm talking a big game for someone who would stand no chance, and you actually, you're probably closer to me than any other guests I've spoken to. So I'm just gonna rein myself in here. Right. So questions. Instagram. Let's see what we've got. So Ryan McRitchie, he asked, which we've really covered this one already, what made Lee start wrestling? So we've established that already. Asked for a wee mention, which he's got. Tick. Easy. We've got Shay Monet asking, favorite thing about Shay Monet?
Oh, that boy. Favourite thing about Shay Monet is the over-the-topness of the whole thing. He's one of the guys that's, like, out there a wee bit, you know? Like, he carries himself and he looks like a star. He looks like one. He doesn't look like somebody off the street. He looks like a star. He acts like a star. He carries himself like a star. I've got a lot of time for Shay, actually. I actually really like him. He's definitely a guy you can learn a lot from. He's been doing it a long time as well, and he's a good guy. I like him. He's probably like one of the only people that I'm like really close with, you know? and that sort of in the asylum scene. He's good at what he does as well, you know. He knows, and
he's got that larger in life thing that I said you really love, which is, yeah, exactly. You don't see Shay Monet as Shay Monet, buying pasta at Tesco. That's the thing you like about that kind of wrestling, where he brings the showmanship to.
Like, this is about Shane, right? Shane is exactly in real life what he is like on that show. He's just a dressed down version of himself on the scene. Like he is exactly the same. He is very, like, just larger than life anyway. Good guy, good energy, you know. But sometimes, like, you think, like, yeah, he's like a star, you know. There's certain people with, like, that X factor to them that you can't explain. Guys.
We've got Morgan Keenan asking opinions on Morgan Keenan.
Yeah, she's just a fan who keeps messaging me all the time.
Who just wants,
I think she fancies me, to be honest. I think she just wants a taste because she messages me all the time. So that is just genuinely it, but she's not going to have me. So,
that's a shame. Anyway, right. Okay. So, Morgan, chill.
Yeah.
Just relax.
Just relax, wee bit.
We did get a question from Ian Skinner. I need to go find it again because it's one of those questions I absolutely hate. But yeah, he insists on asking it. Have you met Ian Skinner? Is it someone who's you've come across in your travels?
Yeah. Never really had a conversation or such with him, but he's always been really nice to me. Always shakes my hand every time he sees me. He's one of the people that'll stop and talk to me. You know, there's like a few boys who've been... No, he's just a nice guy. I've never actually sat and had a conversation with him, but he's always just been nice to me.
Oh, so that's nice. He gets to break your brain with this question and you haven't actually had a proper interaction with him. Okay, so he's asked... I hate him. Would you rather have unlimited bacon and no games, or have games, unlimited games, and no games?
That's such an Ian Skinner question to ask, isn't it?
It really is.
I'm not even going to answer that, to be honest with you.
That's fair. He asked it to me about 2 years ago, and I still don't know how to answer it. It still confuses me, and I'm very easily confused.
He's a wild boy. Do you know what I mean? He's not wild exactly at all.
He's Ian Skinner. I think that's probably the best way to describe it. Right, we asked two questions we ask everyone. I don't know if you'll still pass podcast, other than the one where I didn't even bury you. I didn't even acknowledge you. But I asked two questions to everyone, and they're stupid questions. I know this. They are ridiculous, so I don't mind being told that. First up, what's your favorite dinosaur?
I'm not interested in dinosaurs. I don't like dinosaurs. I don't care about dinosaurs. I don't even know the names.
That's the controversy in this episode, other than myself. Another question we ask everyone is, what would win in a fight, two sheep versus one cow?
I'm not going to answer that question. Ask me a wrestling question. You know what I mean? I'm not
fair enough. Fair enough. right, so the last question we've got is from West Day, which seems like a nice one to kind of start following to the end of our chat here. What would be your ideal wrestling match and match stipulation?
Thing is, right, I'm not like a mark like all the rest of the wrestling fans are, so to be honest, I don't have an ideal match. I don't have an ideal stipulation. I just go in there and beat people up and win and get paid for it. All these dream matches and this, that, the next thing, you know what I mean? Okay, main event of WrestleMania, there you go, sort of thing. That's total. But to be honest, I don't really have a dream situation, do you know what I mean? Just
you're kind of not to make it fancy here, but you're kind of already living your dream doing it, so anything you do is part of the dream anyway.
I don't have something like, oh, I must do this, I must do that. I just don't.
You're on this planet to wrestle, and that's it. But this is before we go then, there's two matches that I think are important to maybe mark on again your first proper full year. Would be the match you had at Comic-Con against Sha Samuels and Jack Jester, which one being your coach, one being a highly experienced individual. Yeah. That's quite big. You say you don't know the mark, you'll have dreams, but that's still good. That's a good footnote to have to say you'd be able to rest those guys.
My match with Sha was I learned a lot in that match. I learned a lot in that match. That the only way you would have figured that out is have been in there with him. You know, he's an intense character. He's hard, strong, very strong, and he's very stiff to work with. But he doesn't. He's one of these guys that takes it very seriously, wrestling very seriously. And it was one of those ones, right? So we were on 12:30 that day, and he didn't fly in and get there until 11:55. So I've actually never spoken to Sha before. I think I've seen him once and he went high and that was it. But now he doesn't know who I am. So it was very much a case of, I'll see you out there. And obviously him being the experienced vet, like I just says, is there anything you want to do? And he's like, I'll see you out there. I don't have time. And he was in a really bad mood that day because I think he had Rev Pro the night before as well. So that was a hard day. I don't know how long we had. I think we wrestled for like 13-14 minutes. That was quite an experience, actually. See, I can't. He's somebody, he strives for perfection and everything, you know what I mean? And he won't take bullshit, sort of thing, you know? And he'll, you know. I kind of got a big mouthful from him when I got backstage. Not in a bad way, but just very much how to improve my overall game, which I would have never have had unless I had that match with him. You know, he's really good at what he does. Maybe I could have got him on a better day. But I learned a lot in that match. And then when I faced Jester, that was good fun. Because Jester's very pantomime-y. He's very like that. And I love that style of wrestling, you know. And he's good. I mean, I don't even think he took one bump that whole entire match. He had the place going crazy for him. That was kind of weird, though, because he was there in my first ever training session. You know, I mean, he's essentially just taught me everything. So I suppose if I was ever going to have a full circle moment, even though I hate all those stupid cringy terms, that would be it. But that's the only time I'll ever say it.
Fair enough.
I got a lot of confidence backstage afterwards. So. He's a good guy. You know? I've got a lot of love for that guy. You know what I mean? He's done a lot for me. You know? Generally, he's a man. Jack Jester's the man, man. He's so good at what he does. You know what I mean? And he's, you know, he doesn't owe me anything, but he gives me a lot. He takes me into consideration. He's always... He'll always answer my texts and he'll always sit down and break things down for me. He's just I owe a lot to him.
Excellent. So usually I would break down match by match, but because you've been so kind of open with speaking, we've been able just to have a nice open chat, I think, for the last wee while. It's been really great to get to know Lee MacRae, and I'm looking forward to next time I see you wrestle. To have a bit more word about it. But where can people find out more about Lee MacRae if they want to?
I'm on Instagram, I'm on TikTok, I'm on Facebook. I actually don't know the names off the top of my head. Just type in Lee MacRae, it'll probably come up, do you know what I mean?
What I'll do is I'll get the Instagram one in front of me, just so people do know. And I'll try to put it in the column below. I usually forget, so that's just because I'm a terrible person. Is this your first podcasting experience? It's Lee_MacRae99 for those who need to know. So first podcasting experience. Nobody else has nabbed you so far, so I think we've done okay.
First time. Watch that Shug's party match, right?
I will do so. But before we stop the recording, that's my promise. By the time this episode comes out, January 5th, I will have watched Lee MacRae versus Landon Riley from Shug's house party pre-show. Yeah. There you go. Right.
I'll quit about it next time and I'll know if you're lying to me.
I don't doubt that for a second. As long as it's not face to face, I'll just end the call. End the call. Anyway, right. Thank you very much for your time.
Okay. Right. See you, mate.